have a Bible with you, I'd invite you to turn to 1 Chronicles chapter 29. 1 Chronicles chapter 29. We're going to read a few verses, 13 actually, and we will pray and then we'll get started. So Lord, we thank you so much for your goodness to us and this opportunity once again to study the Holy Scriptures. I pray, Lord, you would lead us through this passage so that we might understand it and be encouraged by it. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. All right, 1 Chronicles chapter 29, and we'll begin reading in verse 1. And David the king said to all the assembly, Solomon my son, whom alone God has chosen, is young and inexperienced, and the work is great. For the palace will not be for man, but for the Lord God. So I have provided for the house of my God, so far as I was able, the gold for the things of gold, the silver for the things of silver, and the bronze for the things of bronze, the iron for the things of iron, and wood for the things of wood, besides great quantities of onyx and stones for setting, antimony, colored stones, all sorts of precious stones and marble. Moreover, in addition to all that I have provided for the holy house, I have a treasure of my own of gold and silver. And because of my devotion to the house of my God, I give it to the house of my God. 3,000 talents of gold, of the gold of Ophir, and 7,000 talents of refined silver, for overlaying the walls of the house, and for all the work to be done by craftsmen, gold for the things of gold, and silver for the things of silver. Who then will offer willingly, consecrating himself today to the Lord? Then the leaders of fathers' houses made their freewill offerings, as did also the leaders of the tribes, the commanders of thousands and of hundreds, and the officers over the king's work. They gave for the service of the house of God 5,000 talents and 10,000 derricks of gold, 10,000 talents of silver, 18,000 talents of bronze, and 100,000 talents of iron. And whoever had precious stones gave them to the treasury of the house of the Lord in the care of Jehiel the Gershonite. Then the people rejoiced because they had given willingly. For with a whole heart they had offered freely to the Lord. David the king also rejoiced greatly. Therefore David blessed the Lord in the presence of all the assembly. And David said, Blessed are you, O Lord, the God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and in your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. And now we thank you, our God, and praise your glorious name. January 31st, 1957, is a historic date as it relates to the history of Thanksgiving Day in Canada. For on that date, the second Monday of October was permanently appointed to be observed as a day of general thanksgiving each year. It said, whereas it hath pleased Almighty God in his great goodness to vouchsafe many blessings throughout the years to the people of Canada, we therefore, considering that these blessings vouchsafed for the people of Canada, do call a solemn and public acknowledgement, have thought fit, by and with the advice of our Privy Council for Canada, to appoint the second Monday in October in each and every year as a day of general thanksgiving. And we do hereby appoint the second Monday in October in the year of our Lord 1957 and each year thereafter as a day of general thanksgiving to Almighty God for the blessings with which the people of Canada have been favored. And we do hereby invite all our people of Canada to observe the said day each year as a day of general thanksgiving. I find it interesting that in 1957, not only was Almighty God acknowledged by the Canadian government, but giving thanks to him was encouraged. That was only 67 years ago. And sadly, I have my doubts that that sentiment exists in our government today. It seems to me that a great drifting has taken place. Rather than giving thanks to Almighty God, some Canadians, especially in the humanist community, are fighting for a secular future instead. And to be honest, they've been rather successful in their efforts. When I was young and in school, there was a Bible in every classroom. That's in a public school. Students were encouraged to stand up and pray the Lord's Prayer out loud. The Ten Commandments, which most classrooms had a banner or something on the wall, was thought to be sensible and reasonable. Stores, if you can imagine, were closed on Sundays so that people could go to church. That was then. This is now. Today, hatred for God and His Word is rampant. Some are even trying to have the God clause in the preamble to our Constitution, whereas Canada is founded upon principles that recognize the supremacy of God and the rule of law removed entirely. Like in the days of the prophet Isaiah, our leaders, at least many of them, find the mention of God to be offensive. Nevertheless, for the Christ follower, for the Christian, for the believer, thankfulness to God for His blessings is what's to characterize us. After all, we have much to be thankful for. The Bible is filled with commands for God's people, you and me, to continually give Him thanks. The most repeated verse in the Bible, the familiar, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever," is repeated 44 different times. To the Thessalonians, Paul writes, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and give thanks. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." To the Ephesians, he writes, "Be filled with the Spirit," addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Psalm 100, verse 1, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into His presence with singing. Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations." So let's start with this. What does it actually mean to be thankful? What does thankfulness look like? And what impact, if any, will thankfulness have in the life of a believer? To be thankful is to show oneself grateful. To show oneself grateful. It's to visibly demonstrate and express genuine, heartfelt gratitude for God for receiving something incredibly wonderful. As Christians, we ought to be thankful because not only has Jesus given us new life, but he has saved and fulfilled us as well. We should be thankful because we've been delivered from the kingdom of darkness and we've been reconciled to God. We should be thankful because we are filled with God and are alive in Christ. We should be thankful because our life is hidden in Christ. We should be thankful because we've been chosen by God. We've been sealed by the Spirit for the day of redemption, and we are beneficiaries of an eternal inheritance. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. As he begins this letter to the Ephesians, Paul opens with this emphatic call for Christians to praise and worship God. He declares that since God is the one who blesses believers with all blessings, he is therefore worthy of all our praise. Moreover, he indicates that believers must thank God because he has blessed them in so many ways, including every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Through our identification and union with Christ, we are eligible to receive God's blessings. We have been chosen for adoption. We have been gifted with God's glorious grace. We have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. We belong to the body, to the church. We have obtained a heavenly inheritance. Christians have much to be thankful for, and we haven't even talked about our families. We haven't even talked about our children or our spouse. We haven't mentioned the food on our tables, our jobs, the beautiful weather, or any one of God's other gifts. So the question is, are we thankful? Are we thankful? And if we are, then do we express our thankfulness openly? Is there a spring in our step because of our relationship with God? Even psychologists understand the immense value of gratitude, the conscious effort to count one's blessings. In an article in Psychology Today, psychologists find that over time, feeling grateful boosts happiness and fosters both physical and psychological health, even among those already struggling with mental health problems. Studies show that practicing gratitude curbs the use of words expressing negative emotions and shifts inner attention away from such negative emotions as resentment and envy, minimizing the possibility of ruminating, which is the hallmark of depression. One clinician recommends writing a letter of gratitude to someone who has inspired us in some way. Why? Because gratitude reverses our self-centered priorities. To move from a life of self-pity and misery is essential that we take our eyes off of self and recognize others as being important to us. We can make our day better by making someone else's day better. Real and meaningful happiness involves others. And so when others are happy, we tend to be happy as well. And since the Christian has so much to be thankful for, we should be the happiest people of all. We should not be slow to thank our Lord and God for what he has done for us. When Jesus was traveling from Galilee through Samaria to Jerusalem, he was met by 10 lepers. You might know the story. Now, if you were a leper in the first century, if you were a leper in that day, you were in some real difficulty. Lepers were required to live outside the community. They had to live in isolation. And according to the law, they were to wear torn clothes. They were to let their hair hang loose. And as a warning to anyone walking by, they were to yell, "Unclean. Don't come any closer. I'm here. I'm unclean." A leper wasn't allowed to come within 6 feet of any other human. Boy, does that sound familiar. Including his or own family. 6 feet, please. The disease was considered so revolting that the leper wasn't permitted to come within 150 feet of anyone if the wind happened to be blowing. Lepers were forced to live in a community with other lepers until they either got better or they died. And the only way for a leprous person to ever re-engage with society was to be completely healed and have that healing verified by a priest. And I doubt it happened all that often. Upon seeing the Lord, and while standing at a safe distance, which is what was required by law, the lepers cry out, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." Hearing them from afar, the Lord said, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And so they went, and as they went, they were cleansed. They were healed, and they were made whole. In the day, leprosy was an incurable disease. If you contracted leprosy, you likely died from leprosy, which makes what Luke writes here so incredible. Because of the 10 lepers healed, can you imagine? The 10 lepers healed that day, only one, a Samaritan, was thankful. When the Samaritan perceived that he had been healed, he immediately turned back and ran back to Jesus and praised God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving thanks. Again, thankfulness is a visible expression of heartfelt gratitude. Luke 17, 17, Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." As we look at the text that we read, Chronicles, 1 Chronicles chapter 29, which is David's final recorded speech in this book, we get a sense, I think, of his momentous gratitude to God. As we know, David, the man after God's own heart, had an amazing life filled with incredible victories and humbling defeats. The same young man who defeated Goliath on the battlefield would later commit adultery with Bathsheba and have her husband Uriah killed. By no means was David perfect, far from it, yet his love for God remained constant. Psalm 18, verse 1, "I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies." As an old man who knows his end is near, David takes time to reflect, not only on his long and storied life, but especially on God's goodness to him. And as he remembers his life and God's goodness, David is overwhelmed with gratitude. Now, I need to stop here for a moment because this is something we all can do. We all should do. We would all do well to stop and consider what God has done for us, what he's done for us in the past and what he's doing for us at the moment. And we should celebrate his goodness. As our gracious and compassionate Father, we should not be quick to forget God's goodness. It may just change the way that we think. The habit of recalling God's faithfulness will serve as an anchor, and source of strength as we move forward in our life with him. Don't forget what he's done for you. Don't forget what he's done. William Arthur Ward put it this way: gratitude can transform common days into thanksgivings, turn routine jobs into joy, and change ordinary opportunities into blessings. The psalmist writes, Psalm 77, verse 1, I will, so he's made a conscious decision, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your wonders of old. I will ponder all your work and meditate on your mighty deeds. This is something we can all do, and it's something we should all do. Man, God has brought me through some tough things. God has never left me. God has never forsaken me. I can count on him. One of the things that David wanted to do while he lived in his lifetime was build a house for the Lord, which is what Chronicles chapter 29 is all about. Sadly for him, God refused him the honor of building this house and gave that responsibility to his son Solomon instead. We can only guess, but I've got to think that initially this was kind of bad news for David. But that didn't stop him from participating in this important project. As an old man filled with experience and insight, the king knew that the task of building this temple, something he desperately wanted to do, would be too much of an undertaking by someone so young and experienced as his boy. This would be a momentous building project requiring incredible thoughtfulness and wisdom. And of course, as we read in 1 Kings, this was something Solomon understood as well. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 5. This is probably familiar to most of us when Solomon is asked by God, "What would you like me to give you?" At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I shall give you." What would you say? What would I say? And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant David, my father, because he has walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you, and you have kept for him this great and steadfast love and have given him a son to sit on this throne this day. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of David my father, although I am but a little child. I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too many to be numbered or counted for multitude. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this, your great people?" Notice the beautiful honesty in this young man. Solomon knows that governing without true justice, right and wrong, is to not govern at all. His prayer was to lead Israel in an honest and upright manner, which is something every leader should aspire to. At any rate, knowing Solomon, his young son, would need help, David, at his own expense, had the blueprints for the temple drawn up. And he even wrote the plans for all the decorations, everything down to the last ceremonial fork. Though the king will not participate in the physical building of the temple, nor would he ever see it built, David was still fully invested in the plan. Though by now he is an old and expiring man, David wants to be part of what God is doing, even when he's gone. Wanting to leave a lasting legacy for the Lord his God, the king did everything in his power to see that his son, Solomon, was successful and that the temple would be built. We read of this a little bit earlier in the previous chapter, chapter 28, where David lets everyone know his plan. This is 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 1. David assembled at Jerusalem all the officials of Israel, the officials of the tribes, the officers of the divisions that served the king, the commanders of thousands, the commanders of hundreds, the stewards of all the property and livestock of the king and his sons, together with the palace officials, the mighty men, and all the seasoned warriors. Then King David rose to his feet and said, "Hear me, my brothers and my people. I had it in my heart to build a house of rest for the ark of the covenant of the Lord and a footstool of our God. And I made preparations for building. I had the blueprints drawn up. But God said to me, 'You may not build a house for my name, for you are a man of war and have shed blood. Yet the Lord God of Israel chose me from all my father's house to be king over Israel forever. For he chose Judah as leader, and in the house of Judah, my father's house, and among my father's sons, he took pleasure in me to make me king over all Israel. And of all my sons, for the Lord has given me many sons, he has chosen Solomon, my son, to sit on the throne of the kingdom of the Lord over Israel. He said to me, 'It is Solomon your son who shall build my house and my courts, for I have chosen him to be my son, and I will be his father.'" Understanding that he will not be the builder of God's temple, David doesn't waste time pouting or complaining. Rather, because of thankfulness, because of his deep gratitude for God, he allocates massive resources from the national treasury for this building project. As far as David was concerned, this would be no ordinary building that housed an ordinary king. This palace was not for a human ruler, but for the Lord God himself, who is the true king of Israel. And since that was the case, the king spared no expense. Fact is, when God came to dwell years later in the completed temple, it was a site that lived in the history of the Jewish people. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 1. As soon as Solomon finished his prayer, that was his prayer of dedication to open the temple up, as soon as he said amen, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifice, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priest could not enter the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled the Lord's house. When all the people of Israel saw the fire come down and the glory of the Lord on the temple, they bowed down with their faces to the ground on the pavement and worshiped and gave thanks. They gave thanks to the Lord, saying, "For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever." And the king said to all the assembly, he's got everyone gathered, "Solomon, my son, whom alone God has chosen, is young and experienced, and the work is great. For the palace will not be for man, but for the Lord God. So, because of that, I have provided for the house of my God, so far as I was able, the gold for the things of gold, the silver for the things of silver, and the bronze for the things of bronze, the iron for the things of iron, and wood for the things of iron, besides great quantities of onyx and stones for setting, antimony, colored stones, all sorts of precious stones and marble." But David didn't stop here. In addition to tapping into the national treasury, he dipped into his own personal treasury as well. Not under compulsion, not because he had to, but because of gratitude, because he was thankful to God for his goodness. And that's important. When it came to his finances, David was incredibly generous, understanding that everything he had was directly tied to God's goodness. He wasn't about to be stingy with his own possessions. David's gratitude, which resulted in him giving liberally to this project, superseded any pursuit he might have had for a stockpile of personal wealth. We see this generosity in the New Testament as well. While writing to the Corinthian church, Paul recounts the generosity of the Macedonian believers, those from Thessalonica, Philippi, and Berea, who, because of their thankfulness, their gratitude, gave even beyond their means. To the Corinthians, Paul says, "We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia. For in a severe test of affliction," they were going through a tough time, "their abundance of joy because of gratitude, and their extreme poverty because of their situation, have overflowed in a wealth of" what? Generosity. Generosity on their part, for they gave according to their means, as I can testify, it even beyond their means, of their own accord. Nobody forced them to give anything. Begging, he said, begging us earnestly for the favor of participating in the relief of the saints, those in Jerusalem. Setting an example for all of Israel, David the king will highlight what he is prepared to give because he is thankful. Verse 3, "Moreover, in addition to all that I have provided for the holy house," that is the national treasury, "I have a treasure of my own of gold and silver. And because of my devotion, my gratitude to the house of my God, I give it to the house of my God. 3,000 talents of gold." A talent was about a 75-pound amount. 3,000 talents of gold, of the gold of Ophir, that means the best gold. 7,000 talents of refined silver for overlaying the walls of the house, and for all the work to be done by craftsmen, gold for the things of gold, and silver for the things of silver. After declaring publicly what both the nation and he himself was prepared to contribute, David then gave the people an opportunity to participate as well. Again, not of compulsion. Don't do it if you don't want to do it, but here's an opportunity for you to give to God because you are thankful. Their giving was to be willing and freely, something the chronicler repeats in this passage. If the people want to contribute, then they were to do so from the heart and the spirit. And this was something we saw even earlier when Moses was about to build the tabernacle, and he too asks the people if they want to participate. Exodus 25, verse 2. "Speak to the people of Israel that they take for me a contribution from every man whose heart moves him." That means, I want to do this. "Whose heart moves him shall receive the contribution from me." And in chapter 35, verse 21, "And they came, everyone whose heart stirred him and everyone whose spirit moved him, and brought the Lord's contribution to be used for the tent of meeting." Verse 29, "All the men and women, the people of Israel, whose heart moved them to bring anything for the work that the Lord had commanded by Moses to be done, brought it as a freewill offering to the Lord." In other words, they all gave because they wanted to give. They were so thankful that they wanted to be a part of what God was doing. So then David then offers to his people the opportunity. "Who then will offer willingly?" I'm not telling you what to do, but if you want to participate in this because of your thankfulness, that's awesome. Who then will offer willingly, consecrating himself today to the Lord? Then the leaders of fathers' houses made their freewill offerings, as did also the leaders of the tribes, the commanders of thousands and of hundreds, and the officers over the king's work. They gave for the service of the house of God 5,000 talents and 10,000 derricks, coins of gold, 10,000 talents of silver, 18,000 talents of bronze, and 100,000 talents of iron. And whoever had precious stones gave them to the treasury of the house of the Lord in the case of Jehiel the Gershonite, the treasurer. As we look at our text, what we notice is the direct effect of gratitude in action, thankfulness in the hearts of God's people. In this case, giving to the work of the Lord is a response of joy. Gratitude will release joy. And we see this throughout the Bible. When the Israelites escaped from the Egyptians, when God rescued them in gratitude, what did they do? They rejoiced and sang songs. When Simeon held a newborn Jesus, he too erupted in song. When the wise men worshiped the child Jesus, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh, and they too rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. When the disciples were found worthy of suffering for Jesus' name, to be beaten on account of him, with gratitude in their hearts, they gathered together to do what? To worship and to sing and to offer thanks to God. And here in our text, after giving of their resources with a thankful and grateful heart, David and all of Israel begins to rejoice. Then, after they had given because of thankfulness, the people rejoiced because they had given willingly. For with a whole heart they had offered freely to the Lord. David the king also rejoiced greatly. Giving thanks to the Lord is incredibly important, as it gives credit where credit is due. Thankfulness will keep us humble, and it will direct our hearts toward God. David understood that everything he had, all of his possessions, including his position as king over Israel, had been given him by God. Therefore, he is quick to acknowledge God as his helper, as his provider, as his protector, savior, and as the giver of good gifts. Psalm 28, verse 7, the Lord is my strength and my shield. In him my heart trusts, and I am helped. My heart exults in thankfulness, and with my song I give thanks to him. From what we know of David, any failure to give thanks to the living God was inconsistent with the character of a follower or a believer of God, a worshiper of God. And as Christians, it's important that you and I remember God's mercies and do so with thanks. Because without him, we are entirely lost. Without him, we remain in our sins. Without him, we have no hope. But thanks be to God that through Christ, we have forgiveness of our sins and the hope of eternal life. Are we thankful? Verse 10, David will pray. Therefore, David blessed the Lord in the presence of all the assembly, and David said, "Blessed are you, O Lord, the God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and in your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all." And now we thank you. We as a nation thank you, our God, and praise your glorious name. In this prayer, which sounds a lot like the Lord's Prayer, a now exuberant David acknowledges that though Israel, including himself, had given out of her abundance, they made no donation to the Lord at all. Why? Because he acknowledges that God owns everything. God owns everything. God is God. The kingdom of Israel, he would recognize, is ultimately God's kingdom. 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse 14, he will continue his prayer, and it's just a little bit. I want to just read it. But who am I? Who am I, and what is my people? This is the greatest king Israel knew. Who am I, he would say, that we should be able thus to offer willingly? For all things come from you, and of your own we have given you. For we are strangers before you and sojourners, as all our fathers were. Our days on this earth are like a shadow, and there is no abiding. O Lord our God, all this abundance that we have provided for building you a house for your holy name comes from your hand. Comes from your hand. It's all yours. As king, David knows that he is simply a steward of what has been entrusted to him, including the throne itself. Understanding this, he is quick to give thanks. And while it's fine for us to set aside a single day of the year to give thanks, it simply won't cut it for the Christian. In numerous passages, which we've touched on, the Bible instructs believers to give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God for you. So let me encourage you this morning as I speak to myself. Let's be quick to be thankful. Let's be quick to thank God for his many mercies. Because the moment we take our eyes off self, our worshiping hearts will be lifted to new heights. David's prayer of thanksgiving sprang from sincere gratitude, and the result of his prayer was pure joy. And it will be the same for us. No matter our circumstance, thankfulness to God is to what should characterize us. After all, we have so much to be thankful for. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. I want to read two verses of the old hymn, Count Your Blessings. I'm not sure where you are in your life and what perhaps you're going through, but listen to what the psalm writer says. When upon life's billows you are tempted, tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings. Name them one by one. Count your blessings and see what God hath done. So let's pray. So Lord, we thank you so much for who you are. Lord, that we know you, that you know us, that we belong to you, that because of Jesus, we have an eternal inheritance. I pray, Lord, that if we're going through tough times, we would remember this, that we still have so much to be thankful for. And I pray, Lord, that we, the church, would gather around those who are struggling in life and encourage them and speak into their lives so that they might be encouraged and be thankful themselves. I pray, Lord, we would look out for one another. Because of gratitude, what you have done for us, we would extend that same gratitude to others. Heal us, Lord, of our brokenness. Help us as we mortify sin in our lives. Help us to become disciplined, seasoned followers of yours, that we might be useful in your hand in this day and in this time. We thank you. We thank you, and we thank you. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.